Hello, and welcome to Only Miracles. Please settle into your chair and get comfortable. On the count of three, take a nice, slow breath. One, two, three. Good. You are about to go on a journey spanning 10 years and 10,000 miles. The events depicted throughout the show and the words you hear are real. They are true, and they did happen. Many sources were used to create the script, but the primary materials are two interviews conducted by the Shoah Foundation in 1995. One testimonial is from a man named Ed, and one testimonial is from a woman named Helen. Ed and Helen grew up 3 miles from one another, but did not meet until later in life. More details about Ed and Helen will be shared at the end of the show, but for the moment, that is all you need to know. For now, I ask that you put yourself at the center of their story. Instead of watching events happen to them, I ask that you take their story on and put yourself in their shoes. What if it were you? You are following Ed's story. Now, look over and you will see two signs, one marked Ed and one marked Helen. On the count of three, point at the sign marked Ed. One, two, three. Are you pointing at the sign marked Ed? Good. Now lower your hand. In a moment, you are going to go through that door. But first, we are going to take three more deep breaths. Please shift in your seat one last time and get comfortable. Now place your hands palms down on your lap, and on the count of three, we will take three deep breaths together. Here we go. One, two, three. In. And out. In. And out. Good. Last one. In. And out. Thank you. Now, stand up and wait inside the white box on the floor in front of the door marked Ed. You will all have to stand closely together to fit. Good. Now that we're inside the box, on the count of three, step into the space in front of you. An actor will open the curtain so you can step inside. Are you ready? Here we go. One, two, three.
The nights are the worst. They come and find you. They haunt you. When you're young, it's easy to be distracted. Distracted with the kids, with making the house, with making a life. But when you're older, everything is quiet. And the memories, they come and find you. The nights are the worst. The nights are murder. I was 19 years old, and life was good. We lived in a 5-story apartment building, and all the neighbors knew each other. We were all friends. Everybody knew me, my 5 siblings, my brand new baby sister. It was a teenager's dream. Just 1 million kids running around all the time getting into trouble. We were happy. It was a good life. I had my four brothers, my two sisters, and my group of friends. We were happy. And there was always a dance, always a group of nice ladies to meet. It really was a nice little life. And when we wanted culture, we went to the theater. My favorite part was after the show when we'd head to the park and everyone would crowd around me and I would imitate the famous singers we had just seen. I had a nice voice. It was a lot of fun. And the movies. We loved the movies. We could just hop on the streetcar and go see a show. Our group of friends would curl up in the cold, dark theater and drift away into the magical world of musicals. I loved the big screen. I would sit there and watch and think to myself, I could do that. My voice is good enough. I could sing on the big screen. It was a nice little life. And then we heard rumors of a war. And before we knew it, the invasion began. I don't know what came over me and my brother, but we immediately began marching in search of the Polish army, determined to fight and defend our country. We found a Polish brigade entrenched in a battle, and in our pedestrian clothes, we asked to join them. A Jewish soldier in uniform grabbed me by the shoulders and yelled in my face, "Run! Run for your life! I have to be here, but you don't, so run!" When we returned, there were Nazis in the town square. I was struck by how clean and pressed the Nazis were, and how young they were. They were all so baby-faced, and not all of them were in uniform. Some of them were my neighbors. They made us stand in the streets and stare up at six of my neighbors who were hanging from their necks. As the days passed, they made every Jewish person hand over the keys of their homes and their businesses. They did it in the streets, publicly, so everyone would watch. The cruelty intensified with each passing day. A favorite punishment for being Jewish was to not just cut off the beards of men, but to cut off their cheeks too. Blood filled the gutters. We stood in disbelief as we watched every single synagogue burned to the ground. The final insult was to label us as other. As the violence mounted beyond our wildest dreams, public executions now a daily occurrence, and our family on the verge of starvation, it became clear that I had to leave. My brother Abe and I decided we would give our family two less mouths to feed. We could be Jewish, but we could not be Jewish here. That night, my family and I had a quiet and painful Shabbat. No one willing to break the silence. No one said it, but we all knew this was the end. We could be Jewish, but we could not be Jewish here. In the morning, we would make a run for the new border with Russia in the east. When me and Abe got to the border, it was chaos. Screaming, pushing, madness. I held my head high and walked forward, feigning confidence, pretending I was Christian. When I made it to the other side, Abe wasn't with me. I searched the crowd, and I found him being dragged by a Nazi back across to the German side. Later that day, I was told by a group of travelers that Abe had been brought into a barn and shot. Now alone, I went into hiding and prayed the Russian side would be safe, a place to stay till I could be reunited with the rest of my family after the war. In Instead, the Russians threw me in prison and interrogated me for being a spy. They made me stand for 20 hours a day, then would beat me brutally, then make me stand for 20 more hours, then beat me again. And on, it went like this for weeks. Don't remember my screams, but I do remember the screams of the other prisoners beside me. I will never forget them. I was eventually processed as a 58er, a political dissident, an enemy of the Soviet state. I was sentenced to serve an undetermined amount of time in the Russian slave labor camp system. The gulags. They loaded us into cattle wagon train cars and headed north. No toilets, no windows, no food. As the days passed, the temperature dropped. As people starved, they began to lick the black icicles that formed on the train car walls, a mixture of our frozen breath and the soot belching from the train engine. We were packed so tightly in the train car that as people began to inevitably die, they remained standing upright. A dead man leaned against me for days. Six weeks later, we were 1,000 miles deep into Siberia, just south of the Arctic Circle. When the train doors opened, a frozen cluster of prisoners fell into the snow. We walked over their bodies and stood in line to be processed. First, they took our belongings. Then, they took our clothes. Once naked, they shaved our heads, then our bodies, and they separated us. The wind sliced through my skin like a sword. It was a work for calories program, so if we fulfilled our quotas, then we would receive 500 calories of stale bread at the end of the day. 16 hours a day outside in the lashing snow, we cut down the largest trees and dragged them to the river. We burned far more calories than we consumed, so most of our camp starved to death. The rest of them froze to death. As we trudged through the snow in long lines, prisoners dropped by the side and were left behind. No burial, no goodbye. We would just keep walking. The snow took their bodies. There was always another train. Always more prisoners. Always replacements. The nicest job you could get was one that got you out of the cold. So I was relieved when I was selected to work in the infirmary. To save medical supplies, the Gulag chiefs would decide each night who in the hospital would die. They handed me the needle, and it was my job to euthanize them. I had to kill my friends and fellow inmates, but I was warm.
It felt so good to be warm.
There was no fence, no barbed wire, no perimeter. Only 1,000 miles in every direction of frozen wasteland that would eat you alive. I watched a man lose his mind, strip naked, and run into the forest. That's what suicide looks like in Siberia. No one tried to stop him. We all just stood there, emotionless, and watched. After 2 years of surviving in Siberia, we learned that the Polish government in exile had negotiated on our behalf, and Polish prisoners would be moved farther south. The prisoners from my camp hiked 100 miles to take boats south, but the river was frozen solid, so we hiked another 100 miles through the frozen landscape. Many prisoners died on the march, but at night, I set snares and would check them in the morning before we left. I captured a rabbit, and for the first time in 4 years, I had protein. I filled my belly with rich meat and pressed on. After 200 miles of hiking in the snow, we arrived at another camp. I couldn't believe how big it was. 60,000 prisoners. How could Russia have so many enemies? I met a woman, and it turned out that we were from the same town and lived just 3 miles apart from one another our whole lives. We had had very similar childhoods, big families, big friend groups, went to the same dances and the same movie theaters. And for the past 4 years, we had been traveling alongside one another. She told me that the Russian government was rounding up single people to fight their newest enemy, Germany, and that we should get married so neither of us would be conscripted. She proposed that we get married and combine our skills. A marriage of survival, not one of love. It made sense. So I agreed. We worked with what was available, and we had a real wedding. We made a chuppah from sticks and an old piece of fabric. We made a ring from my sleeve. And we couldn't find a glass, so we tied a bundle of twigs together, which worked just fine. When we were set, she extended her hand, and I placed the fabric ring on her finger. It was joyful, but also filled with deep sadness. I never imagined that my brothers would not be present for my wedding day. To complete the ceremony, I raised my leg high in the air and stomped as hard as I could. No one said Mazel Tov. 9 months later, against all odds, my bride gave birth to a baby girl. Due to malnutrition, not a single woman in the camp could have their period. And yet, with no food, no clothes, and no medical supplies, my new wife carried to term and delivered a healthy girl. We named our new baby Rose, but throughout the camp, she became known as the Miracle Baby. In negative 30 degrees and with no food, Rose was about to die. Word spread that the war was over, and not a minute too soon. After 5 years and 5,000 miles, we were given permission to return home. For 6 weeks, we sat in a daze on that train, our heads swirling, processing the 5 years of hell we had survived. I was in disbelief that I had not only not died in the camps, but instead made a family. I had gotten married and was now a father. Over the rumbling on the train, my sick baby cried in my wife's arms for weeks. We stared out of the train window as an endless landscape of carnage and ruin passed by. As far as the eye could see, nothing but charred buildings, burning fields, broken bodies, and rubble. It was on that train that a lady had fruit, and she gave me some. It was the first time I had had fruit in 5 years. That piece of fruit was one of the most incredible things I had ever tasted. The world was burning, but I was eating fruit. And then we were home. Silently, we walked through the charred remains of my wife's town, her neighbors' houses marked with the horrors of war. And then my wife went cold, staring at her childhood home, a sign with her family's name hanging above the door, just like she had said. With a trembling hand, she knocked on the front door. I knew that her heart was racing, filled with expectation that her mother would open the door and keep her promise that she would be right there when her daughter returned and throw her arms around her. But instead, a strange man opened the door. He stared at my wife blankly, suspicious, and unsure who she was. Then it clicked, and he said, "You? You're alive? I thought you were dead." "Everyone is dead." And he shut the door in her face. I threw my arm around my wife as she almost collapsed, and we staggered along the side of the house toward a well in the backyard. I placed her on the stone edge of the well, and she quietly stared down into the darkness. I could feel her body gently pitching forward, forward, her weight beginning to shift. Then Rose repositioned herself in my wife's arms and quietly fell back asleep. Her hypnotic gaze broke. Then she fell to her knees and began to dig. And I joined in. We could be Jewish, but we could not be Jewish here.
la vie, la perle, der Mond ist die Laterne, steht am dunklen Himmelszelt und schaut hernieder auf die Welt. Der Mond ist die